Hi, Corpus Christi. Welcome to another Better Way Ministry Bible study. Today's study, hope. Hope. What are you hoping for? If you could have the Lord do anything for you, what would it be? If right where you're sitting, you get a knock on a door, and you go to the door and you answer, and it's the Father of the Lord Jesus Christ. So after he picks you up off the floor, you wake up and you find yourself sitting in your own home. And the Father of glory, the Father of lights, is sitting across from you. And he looks at you and he says, "You awake now?" He's smiling. He so loves you. You can feel the presence of his love coming at you from his eyes. And he says, "I got something for you. But before I give it to you, there's something I want you to tell me." And he says, "What are you hoping for?" If you were able to tell him anything, anything at all, what would you tell him your hope was in him? Hope. Every word of God is pure. If you get anything out of this ministry, if you have a King James Bible and you pick up that King James Bible, those words are spirit. Those words are life. Jesus said, "My words are spirit and they are life." Because he didn't give us his own words, he gave us the Father's words. Every word of God is pure. You can go into a King James and drown in it. Don't ever come out. Just jump in and drown and don't ever come out. God is good to us. He said he would preserve his thoughts to every generation. And he has done that in a King James Bible. The NIV, that's a Rupert Murdoch product. It's had various editors as they continue to revise it. They revise it because they think God changed his mind. Oh no, that's right. Because it just doesn't fit anymore. And then they look at the King James and say, "Oh, that's old." God is going to laugh at that. But if you've been deceived into that, you can repent and you can go get a King James and burn that other one. Or if you have a new King James, burn it. Why would you want what is not pure? Why would you base your life? Why would you be looking for a rapture that God never said in a King James Bible? There is no rapture. Who is it? Just stop and think with me for a minute. Who is it said look for a rapture? God uses his word. You want the day of Christ is what you're looking for. That is, if you've put on Christ, if you have repented and been baptized in the name of the Christ, whose name is Jesus, he is the Lord's Christ for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You know, to whom much is given, much is required. I was talking with a person the other day, yesterday. And I said, you know, there's a lot of people in this world, and bless their hearts, some ignorant, some just lazy, whatever the reasoning, I don't know. But I have heard many times it said, "Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, nor entered into the heart of man, the things that God hath prepared for those that love him." And they stop there. They stop there because they don't have the Spirit and that's in the next verse, has it been revealed to them? Because the very next verse says, but he has revealed them unto us through his capital S, Spirit. If you have the Spirit, then this Bible study of hope is for you. If you don't have the Spirit, repent and be baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of your sins. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, what that Holy Ghost is going to do, he's going to give you power over your own will, over all the works of darkness, by the name that you're baptized into. But he, the Holy Ghost power, will give you power over your own will, that you are not stuck in your own iniquity. And you can be fit for the Master, unto the Father's service. Hope. The Lord upholdeth. Regardless of how you answered that first question, regardless of what it is that you would like for the Lord to do for you, regardless of that, it's our Lord that upholds us until the hope is manifest. Let's take a look. The Lord upholdeth all that fall, and raises up all that be bowed down. We all fall. We all don't have to fall, but we have all fallen short of the glory of God. After we are in Christ, look at what Peter says about the hope. The Apostle Peter, Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like faith. No, like precious faith. The precious faith that removed us from the world system and let us enter into the kingdom of God, where we take no thought for our life, that the blessings of Abraham overtake us because we are the seed through Christ of every promise. To them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and of and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Grace and peace. The grace to change everything in your life by the power of God. The grace to get rid of the oppressor of this earth. The grace to be protected from the destroyer of this life. And peace. Once you get rid of him, peace. You know, my granddaughter goes to school in a different state than where I'm at. I'm not worried somebody's going to go there and do anything to that child. You cannot keep yourself. Safety is of the Lord. He didn't go to sleep today. Oops, sorry. I didn't see that guy. The Ancient of Days, the precious faith that we have in him. Peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. According, I'll get this. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. Did you earn them? No, they are given unto us through the kingdom of God. It's not because you get up. It's not because you're diligent. I'm not saying don't get up, and I'm not saying don't be diligent and don't be faithful. I'm not saying those things. But they're given to you through the precious faith. Given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So now we're going to learn through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Those, they're divine promises. The promise that nobody in the Old Testament got the Holy Ghost. We, only after Christ has circumcised your heart and you put off the body of the sins of the flesh. Anybody that touched God in the Old Testament, anybody that touched anything that God had touched, died in the Old Testament. Unless they were explicitly given direction to come into his presence, they died. You show up, you put your hand on the ark, you die. How is it then that the Holy Ghost can come to us? Through the operation of God. You're supposed to have faith in the operation of God in Colossians 2. Through faith in the operation of God that raised Jesus from the dead. That by the circumcision of your heart, you have put off the body of the sins of the flesh. As vile as this flesh may be, it's no longer sinful when you put off the body of the sins of the flesh. Think about this. As circumcision was in the Old Testament, so the circumcision of our heart is this day. It's no less meaningful. It is even more meaningful because we have a better covenant than they had. Our blood is, the Testament, the New Testament is written, Jesus said, and it, he goes, I wrote it in my own blood. It's his blood. Oh. Talk about hope. That you can be partakers of the divine nature. Now, if you're worried, overcome with fear, and you're going off to every seminar that there is, and you don't have time to be in the presence of God and let your way be established, then I suggest you start immediately. Because in his presence is the fullness of joy. In his presence. We have to learn of him. The people in the Old Testament, David got a man killed while he was trying to bring the Ark of the Covenant back because he sought not God after the proper order. So he went to the Word. He got the proper order. You know, that guy didn't wake up that morning and say, you know what? I bet I die today. They were joyful. Ah, man, I get to drive the cart with God in the back of it. He was excited. Oh, David's excited. He has every officer, every major figurehead in all of Israel. The whole country is there for this celebrated event of bringing the Ark to the city of Jerusalem. Oh, it is much sought after. There has been preparation. Oh, it is a big deal. This guy, he wakes up. He's all excited, and he died that day. The ark did not come that day. It's not that God was being mean, but you know what? After 400 years, after 400 years, you're supposed to have gained a little knowledge about God. Throughout our life, if you're reading your Bible and not attending to it, you need to begin to attend. You need to consider the works of God in your life. He wants to come to you. He's not going to It's not, well, there's a lot of things that it isn't. He wants to come to you. He wants to love you personally and make you the partaker of his divine nature. The fact that's even in his heart for us is amazing. Having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Whoops. How many of us would say that we've escaped? We can. And you're going to, by the power of the Holy Ghost. You have to have the Holy Ghost. Nobody in the Old Testament was able to keep the law. Nobody. Jesus had to come and keep the law. And fulfill that to separate us so that we would have the hope of being separated from the law of sin and death. Let's keep going. And beside this, giving all diligence to your faith, add virtue. And to virtue, knowledge. And to knowledge, temperance. And to temperance, patience. And to patience, godliness. And to godliness, brotherly kindness. And to brotherly kindness, charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, first of all, our Father wants us to have fruit. He wants us to have the knowledge. He wants us to be able to multiply grace, multiply peace in our life. And it's going to come through the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. When those attributes of Christ abound in you, male and female, when they abound in you, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word. So to have a knowledge of God, you're not going to get it off the street corner. You're going to get it right here in this word. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off and hath forgotten that he was purged from his own sins. Wherefore the rather, brethren, now listen to this, give diligence to make your calling and election sure, for if you do these things, ye shall never fall. But if you do, fall. What did it say at the beginning? The Lord upholdeth all that fall. Abraham gave away Sarah twice. God never called him on the carpet for that. This is the father of faith. This is the father by whom the promise of Christ entered this world. Because of his faith that was accounted unto him for righteousness. God is not keeping track where we fall. He's not keeping track of where you failed him or where you've fallen. God has concluded the whole world under sin. We're all wrong, folks. We're just not all wrong in the same spot. So how do you get out of this? Knowledge. We study. We give diligence. Diligence. To make our calling and election sure. He that doeth thee, for if you do these things, if you do them, if you do them. He didn't say if you read about them. But you're going to have to read them in order to know what to do. But you can read and you can stop and you're going to be attacked at every single point along the way by the destroyer. By Satan. By the devil. He's going to, first of all, he's going to make it where you don't read. Because you have to read in order to attend. Then he's going to say, oh, reading's good enough. You don't really have to attend, but if you want understanding, you will. And then you understand, but now I'm waiting. I'm waiting for everything to get just right so I can do something. We are as Christ is in this world, and we are without excuse. And God has given everything unto us that pertains unto life and godliness. He's given it. It's not because you got up early and went off to your job. That job came because of godliness, because of the goodness of God. We don't live from our wages. Our living is from our giving. In the kingdom of God, where you can escape the corruption of this world. How? By the promises. Did he say you can escape the corruption that's in this world? Did he say you could be partaker of the divine nature because of your own works? No, it's because of a promise. A promise. Well, you're going to have to know what the promise is. You're going to have to understand what the promise is. And then you're going to have faith and believe that the person that made the promise will keep the promise. But if your faith is in the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things? For if you do these things, ye shall never fall. So, for so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. What do you want today? When I said that originally, did you want healing? Did you want finances? Did you want security? Did you want get rid of fear? Did you want health? What was it that you answered? Think about it. Would you like an entrance to be abundantly ministered to you into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? Would you like to have, when the Father came over and he said, I have something to give you, and he said, tell me what you want. And then he looked at you and he said, I'm going to give you, I'm going to minister in abundantly an entrance into the everlasting kingdom. Would you take it? Would you say, oh, Father, I want that? Because we can enter the kingdom now. The only thing we're waiting on is our body. Even though it's sinless, it's still vile. And it's not going to be redeemed. It's going to get changed. There's no redeeming this. The soul has been redeemed. God is a living soul. We're made in the image of God. God is a soul. But he gave us a body to carry this soul about. And we're going to have a body because Jesus has a body. And we're going to be just like he is. Oh. But wouldn't you like to have this entrance ministered unto you by the Father himself? Well, you can. That's the good news. You can. And you can have health while you're waiting for the changing of this body. We can have health. You can have the finances. He reminds us, I got all the gold and silver. He's kind of waiting for you to ask him for some. He's waiting for you to study and learn and get a little knowledge. Oh, he'll reward you. Oh, he will reward you for studying. He will reward you for not following your flesh, but allowing the Spirit of the living God to sanctify you from the works of the flesh. That's our God. Hear ye, children, the instruction of a father, and attend to no understanding. Remember what we were saying about the Bible earlier? You have to attend to understand, to get, to to know understanding. You're not going to get understanding by reading the Bible. You're going to get understanding when you attend. Think about children attending school. Okay? What is the preparation that we give to them so that they may attend? And what is it we expect them to do? We expect them to come out knowing something. But what'd you do today? Yeah. What if the father came down and said, well, what'd you do today? Yeah. See? And attend to know understanding. Wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. That's that same father that came to your door and said, I got something for you. I'm going to minister to you an abundant entrance into the everlasting kingdom. Now here's what I'd like. Wash you. Call. Repent your ways. Call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You will get baptized if you called on Him, because the Spirit's going to lead you to get baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of your sins, and then you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So He will wash you and make you clean, but your desire has to be yours. Put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes. Cease to do evil. That's repentance, folks. Learn to do well. Now you're attending the word. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. This is our Father. He never has changed. From when He made man so that He could walk with man, He obviously had Adam. He was pruning the garden. And God didn't. He's not an unreasonable God. In the cool of the day, after the work was completed, He would come and He would walk with Adam and talk with him. Adam's like a child in His eyes. Look, he had no knowledge of evil. He had no knowledge of good. Adam only had a knowledge of being in the presence of God. How would you like that? Wow. But anyways. And they talked. Come now, let us reason together. God wants you to regard the works of the Lord in your life. How are you going to do that if you don't meditate with Him? How are you going to do that if you're not in prayer and supplication with the Lord? Though your sins be as scarlet, they will be as white as snow. We have a better covenant. It's the blood of the Lamb. We don't sin afterwards, but He expects us to become a doer of His word and to put away the works of the flesh. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. There's going to be a change. You're supposed to be come out of that baptism water a new creature, ready for the Holy Ghost to enter you. If you did not get the Holy Ghost, why not? How is it that you were baptized? That's what Paul asked everybody. If they got the Holy Ghost. If you be willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. Now this is an Old Testament. But yet, it's applicable to us. Because this, in 1 Corinthians 10, is written for our example and our end sample. These two words are different. They have different meanings. But this scripture fulfills them both. so that we will not lust after evil things. I want you to know the hope that whatever it was that you're hoping for, you're going to get all of that on your way to receive the entrance administered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. You're going to get everything else. It doesn't always manifest in everyone's life because they don't look at achieving it as it coming from a promise. They look at achieving it as if they learn, as if they do something. And it isn't. Safety is of the Lord. Health is of the Lord. The entrance is certainly of the Lord. My son, if thou wilt receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply your heart to understanding, yea, if thou criest after knowledge and liftest up your voice for understanding, if thou seekest her as silver and searchest for her as for hid treasures. If you seek her as silver, let's say the father's sitting there and he goes, you know what? I hid a bag of money in this house last night. You did? Yep. And it's in this house. And now I hid it really good, but you can find it. Wow. I'll just wait here while you go looking. And you take off looking. How would you look? Would you have an expectation of finding it? If he's sitting on the couch and he goes, if you seek her as silver, I will give you wisdom. I will give you understanding. I will give you the abundant entrance into the everlasting kingdom of Jesus Christ. Then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord giveth wisdom. Out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is a buckler to them that walk uprightly. He keepeth the paths of judgment and preserveth the way of his saints. Then shalt thou understand righteousness and judgment and equity, yea, every good path. Do you want to understand every good path? Would you like to know how to stay in the good path so that there is a reward at the end of the day, at the end of the week, at the end of the month, that there's more than enough, that now you have enough that you can be a blessing to others, that you can be the light and let them see the light in you, that hope of glory? You're going to have to study. Out of his mouth cometh wisdom and knowledge. He lays it up. It's just like sitting there telling you the bag of silver is in your house. Search for the wisdom of God like you're looking for the silver. Okay? You're going to find it. It's not hidden where you'll never find it. It's hidden so you'll pay attention to him. And pay attention to his words. So that we find it. Because trust me, the word of God works. It works for the rebellious. Those people that come up to Jesus Christ. And he says, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. And they say, whoa, 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 whoa. Their eyes get big. Nobody has argued with God ever. These people are the first people that I've ever seen in the Bible that actually argued with God. And they say, hey, look. We did mighty works with your name. We were using your name. He goes, depart from me, I didn't know, but we were doing mighty works with your name. We cast out devils with your name. Depart from me, I didn't know you. You didn't repent your way. His word works. So he hides these treasures for us, so that people don't think that they've got it done. But some people, you're probably going to church. We all are probably going to church with those people who are going to look at the Lord and say, wow, me? I'm going to go to hell? Can you imagine what a shock it is? And the whole time the Lord's knocking on their heart saying, hey, 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 it's my word. It accomplishes what I want. Now you can send it out there and think it's doing some good, because they were casting out, they were doing miracles. He said, but without me, you can do nothing. Do you have that rivers of living water coming out of your belly? Because if you don't, that is the Spirit that you're supposed to be sealed, who is leading you to the sanctification of your spirit, so that you will get baptized into the name of Jesus and get the circumcision of your heart, so you can put off the body of the sins of the flesh, so you can get the Holy Ghost, so you can conquer your own iniquity, your own way, so that you can get to the Father's will. The whole time Jesus was on his earth, it was not at his own pleasure. When he was 12 and his parents found him, he goes, wist ye not, I must be about my Father's business. What was he doing? Learning. The task his Father had for him, he was preparing him for. The task that the Father has for you, he's going to prepare you for. But if you don't attend, if you're not learning, if you're not growing, if you're not seeking, if you're not searching for it like it's hid treasure, you miss. You just think because his word works, you're doing something right. No, it's the word of his power. His word goes and does according to what he says. That doesn't mean that you've repented so that you have eternal life. Look, people, this word is pure. Eternal life is not being saved. The word saved does not necessarily mean eternal life. Why are there two words? Well, three words. Eternal life is over here and saved is over there. They're not interchangeable. His word is pure. You're going to have to learn. But if you do, they'll make you that you never fall. That you're not unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. That you can escape the corruption. You can be partakers of the divine nature through the great and precious promises. His divine nature. People in the Old Testament, they weren't partakers of his divine nature. Whoa. But we can be. Man, the person that walked this earth that had the most power, who could have asked his Father for 12 legions of angels, that's almost 100,000 angels. When he said presently, that's not even the twinkling of an eye. That's present. Without time. Time doesn't enter into present. Don't you know that I could presently call for 12 legions of angels? I'm not doing my will. I'm doing the Father's will. But he went to the cross with the knowledge that if he asked, he could get out of that. But he had a mission, and he fasted and prayed, not my will, thine be done. Only by the power of the Holy Ghost did he overcome that. He keepeth the paths of judgment and preserveth the way of his saints. Then shalt thou understand righteousness and judgment and equity, yea, every good path. When? when you're looking for it, like you're looking for hidden treasure, you're going to find it. And you're going to have to take it by faith that you will. But I'm here to tell you, you will. You're going to find that and so much more. You're going to find out what a pushover the Father is. He looked at us and he said, look at your best state. You're altogether vanity. Don't worry, I love you. I gave my only son for you. If I gave my only son for you, do you not think I will freely give you all things? Freely. Just start learning. Some things you have to learn how to take care of. We want the shortcut of obtain something without the knowledge of how to take care of it and appreciate it, and to cultivate it. Not our Father. He knows what it takes for the seed to bring forth fruit. Then shalt thou understand righteousness and judgment and equity, every good path. When wisdom entereth into thine heart, and knowledge, it no longer scares you. there was a long time, boy. I'd learn something, I'd go, uh-oh. My eyes get big, uh-oh. I just knew I was in big trouble. I thought, man. When wisdom enters into your heart and knowledge is pleasant unto your soul, discretion shall preserve you. Discretion comes from within you. He's making us into the divine nature. It's not that we wake up in the morning and say, I'm putting it on. It comes from precious, exceeding great and precious promises by you going into the promises and finding those promises like they're hid treasure. And the Father's sitting up there and he's making you into him without you knowing. Sometimes we know, sometimes we don't. Discretion shall preserve you. Understanding shall keep you. Oh, he walked in your house this morning. He goes, I've hidden this in your house. Look for it. If any of you need a King James Bible, write this. You write me. Tell me your name and how to spell it correctly. I'll even put your name on it for you. But he was wounded for our transgressions. Talking about Jesus. Talking about the better covenant. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. All right, we're about a little more than a third in, and I got a little more than 10 minutes left. I got a 1/5 of my time left. How does that work? All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. You need the Holy Ghost power if you're going to be able to overcome your iniquity. The Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. Forsake not the works of thine own hands. He showeth his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto Israel. Now then, there's a difference between Jacob and Israel, and we're going to find that out here in the next verse. He shows his word to Jacob. But to Israel, he shows statutes and judgment. Now, they're contained in the word. He just shows the word to Jacob. He hath not dealt so with any nations, and as for his judgments, they have not known them. Why? Because they showed him the word, didn't show him the statutes and judgments. Why? But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee, O Israel. These are the same man. Jacob is Israel. After he wrestled with God, God changed his name. Okay, now you're Israel. He could have just named him Israel right out of the womb. He didn't do that. He wanted Jacob to have an interest in what God had to give. Come to me. Look for it. Come on. Hey. And he got it. He wrestled God. Could God not have gotten rid of him? You betcha. With a thought, it's not his pleasure to get rid of him. It's his pleasure that we seek for the treasures of God as for silver and gold. You'll find them. Seek. So now that he does seek, what does it say up here? He shows his statutes and his judgments to Israel. Whoa. It's more than a book now. Now I'm getting statutes. Now I'm getting his judgments. Now I'm able to walk in this life and not wring my hand. Am I pleasing or not? And he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. See, by the time you get to be Israel, you're formed. He's redeemed you. So now he goes, hey, don't fear. I have called thee by thy name. Thou art mine. Jacob? Mm-mm. The promise was to Jacob, but Jacob, he had to be converted. He had to be formed into Israel. Remember when Jesus looked at Peter and he goes, when you're converted, man, he walked with them for 3 years. He wasn't converted. The Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. He made known his ways unto Moses. Moses was a man, he was God's friend. He was the meekest man on the earth. So, first there's Jesus' meekness that the earth talks about, that the word talks about. And because he was the meekest man, he never even opened his mouth. But he did look at Pilate after Pilate said, don't you know, you're not going to answer me? Don't you know I got power over you to kill you and keep you alive? Jesus looked at him and said, you got no power at all against me unless it's given you from above. Whoa. He put a spear clear through Pilate that Herod sought to set him free. Well, I'm not sure right now. I can't think if it was Pilate or Herod, but nevertheless, whoever he was talking to, he said, you have no power at all against me. He made known his ways unto Moses. Moses knew the ways of God. He was his friend. He'd sought the Lord for 40 years. God was just waiting for all of Moses to get out and he could move in to use him for a very specific purpose. But he wasn't going to do it. When Moses broke the man's neck, he had to go get, come on, Moses. I'm not going to sit. You're not a one-man M1 Abrams tank. You're not going to go through all the earth breaking everyone's neck. I don't operate like that. I want to use my power that you do not possess. But I'm not going to give this power to you unless you will use it the way I say. That's what got Moses killed. He used the power of God, but not like God said. He told him the second time, speak to the rock. Sanctify me by in front of all the children of Israel by speaking to the rock. And Moses hit the rock the second time. And for that, he did not enter. But he made known his acts unto the children of Israel. All they could see was what was going on. They had no understanding. They weren't converted. They weren't formed. They were just his kids. He says, come on, I'm going to take you, but you're going to have to learn some stuff. And they had. But he made known his ways to Moses. And we have a better covenant than Moses. The Lord is merciful, gracious, slow to anger, plenteous in mercy. He will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He hath not dealt with us after our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our transgressions from us. Like as a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear him. For he knoweth our frame, he remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are as grass, as a flower of the field, so he flourishes, for the wind passes over it, and it's gone, and the place thereof shall know it no more. Look out your window, you see that flower, and a big windstorm comes. The next day, you look out there, flower's gone. Hey, where'd that go? And you start looking. You don't look till it's just gone. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon them that fear him. You want his mercy? Just fear him. And his righteousness unto his children's children. What a generational promise that is. How would you like to pass down the righteousness of God to your grandchildren? Then get into the covenant. Learn. Be a partaker of his divine nature. This applies to you today. To such as keep his covenant, and to them that remember his commandments to do them. God's looking for somebody that will wrestle with him, that'll reason with him, that'll talk to him, that'll learn, that'll seek, that will look. And to them, nothing will be withholden. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Hearken unto me, O Jacob, and Israel my called. I am he, I am the first. I also am the last. Just listen to me. I'm the first, I was before you, and I'm the last. I'm going to be after you. I'm all you need. Just me. Just listen. Hearken. All right, Father, I don't know where I'm going to be able to. Mine hand also hath laid the foundation of the earth, and my right hand hath spanned the heavens. When I call unto them, they stand up together. What an awesome God. We have a telescope. It's named Hubble. It sits out there revolving around our earth, but it's looking the other direction, finally. And as we look out there, there are more galaxies than we can count, like the Milky Way galaxy. And each galaxy has billions of stars within every one, and there are billions of galaxies. And this is just the part that that little thing can look at. We have no understanding about how big the heaven is. None. But God calls the heavens. He goes, my hand also hath laid the foundation of the earth, and my right hand spanned the heavens. When I call unto them, they stand up together. This is the God that went into your house and sat down and said, what are you hoping for? I want to know what you're hoping for. But I got something for you. Search for the admission, the entrance, the abundantly into the kingdom, the everlasting kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is a place of grace and mercy multiplied. It is a place of joy multiplied. I will praise thee with my whole heart. Before the gods will I sing praise unto thee. I will worship toward thy holy temple and praise thy name. For thy loving kindness and for thy truth. For thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. In the day when I cried, thou answered me and strengthened me with strength in my soul. You know, we're going to leave it right there. Call on the name of the Lord. Call on him. He'll seal you with his spirit. You'll begin the sanctification process right then. And if you will cry out for knowledge, if you'll get into this word, into this pure word, a King James Bible, and start getting knowledge, you'll never be the same. And you will be eternally grateful for the abundantly administered entrance into the glorious kingdom, the glorious everlasting kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ. Corpus Christi, grace to you.
earth without form and void. By the spoken word of God, God created the whole universe, the world that we live in. The trees that we see outside, they came forth by the word of God. And John chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God.